So, without further ado, and slightly behind schedule, we open the debate with Cornelius Holtorf speaking in favour of the motion that this House believes that archaeological resources are not finite and are renewable. Over to you, Cornelius.
Okay, Cornelius?
I have an instruction, but now it's my turn, is it?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Well, hello, everybody in the room. I hear some echo, but I guess I'll just push on. You can hear me okay, can you?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Okay. So I thought I'll introduce my case in four parts. The first one is a few definitions. The second is an introduction to the argument, the context. And then the main substance of the argument will be presented in two parts. And at the end, I have a very short conclusion which points towards some implications of the argument. So let's start with the definition. And I think Sarah is ready there to put them on the whiteboard.
I will, yes.
The first one is the statement is that this house believes that archaeological resources are not finite and are renewable. So let's discuss and define the term. Archaeological resources, I think, can be defined as tangible objects that can remind us of the human past. And what that, Sarah?
Yeah.
And finite means limited.
Yeah.
So I followed what I got from that. So I said that finite means limited in quantity and renewable can be defined as something that can be regenerated when used up or destroyed. Okay now?
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
Okay, so to introduce my claim here, this is really a claim I've felt passionate about for some years. In fact, I noticed that this is now almost 15 years that I've developed these ideas. And I guess they are as fresh as ever, and I certainly still feel that I should be arguing for that. And back then, as much as today, you can say that it has become a cliché to confirm the need to preserve unique archaeological heritage and to prevent its destruction for the benefit of future generations. This is being repeated all over again in many policy statements on archaeological and heritage context. I just want to give you one example, which is from the Global Heritage Fund. They published a few years ago a little booklet called Saving Our Vanishing Heritage. And they formulate this idea as follows. Quote, like endangered species, many archaeological and cultural heritage sites are on the verge of extinction. They are irreplaceable and finite resource. Without action to protect them now, accelerating economic pressures will end global history. And once they're gone forever. End quote. So this is the sort of position that you find in many documents. And as you will imagine, I want to claim here the exact opposite. Archaeological resources, that is, tangible objects that can remind us of the human past, are not finite, but replaceable and indeed renewable. Despite destructive processes to which some archaeological resources are subjected from time to time, they are never gone in their entirety, neither collectively nor individually. Therefore, archaeological resources cannot be said to be on the verge of extinction. If anything, archaeological resources are growing and gaining in significance over time and increasing in quantity. Consequently, preservation should not be motivated ethically in the way it is often done. For example, in the quote I read out earlier to the Global Heritage Fund. And in any case, preservation of archaeological resources does not necessarily benefit future generations, or we cannot be certain about that. So this is the introduction to the claim. And the argument I want to make comes in two parts. And these two parts are interconnected. They hang together. They're just two different ways of looking at the same issue. So the first substantive argument here is that I would argue that the quality of archaeological resources matters most. The quality and not the quantity, that is. Archaeological resources are not significant in the unique fabric of each item, but rather in their use and function in society, which is, of course, a reminder of the human past. So it doesn't matter, it's not each object that is significant, but it's what they do in society. For example, if you think about Stonehenge, on one hand, which everybody knows, then it's not the very stones that are the key of the matter, but it's what they do. It's the various religious, educational, inspirational, and also social uses and functions this monument plays in society. It's that which makes it significant, and it's that what can be and is being valued in society. Therefore, archaeological resources are not limited in quantity, they're not finite, because the way in which we can be reminded of the past through tangible objects is not limited in quantity either. A lot of things can tell stories and remind us about the past, and it doesn't need to be a specific thing. At any point, an unlimited amount of new archaeological resources can be identified or generated that possess historical value and can tell important stories about the human past. Now, to stay with the example of Stonehenge, I thought I'd point to the blue stones that can be found through today in the Preseli Mountains in Wales, and you've probably heard about that as well. It's a whole mountain consisting of the same stones that were used in Stonehenge as well. And okay, it's not literally unlimited because it's still a mountain and you know only so many tons of stone. But you can every little piece of these stones can be linked to the history of Stonehenge. In fact, the mountains that have been linked to the history of Stonehenge can tell some of the same story, even though they were not actually used by the people who built Stonehenge, but they can still fulfill the use and function to remind them of half the same part as the real Stonehenge can do. So this is the one substantial argument, and it's the quality of what archaeological resources do in society that is important, rather than the quantity of individual items that we might have. And the second point is that heritage cannot go extinct as a result of destruction. So you could also say that destruction has been overrated in our field. Destruction of specific archaeological resources does not lead to loss, but to transformation. And that transformation can even increase the significance in society. Now, what does that look? Think of the Berlin Wall, for example. Now, this is also a monument which everybody knows. And it was destroyed in 89 and the years after that. Large sections, there will be small parts which are left today. But that doesn't mean it has no longer any significance in society. In fact, it has more significance now than ever before. And all these monuments that have disappeared from the original location are now on display around the world in all kinds of different contexts, in museums, private homes, public, where you find that wherever you go. Indeed, if you count and weigh all this material, then it's probably more than the original Berlin Wall ever contained. And that doesn't matter because it all tells the story, or it tells one story about the German reunification at the end of the Cold War, and all that happened back in 1989. So, if anything, it was an enhancement rather than a problem that the wall was destroyed and sold off and displayed around the world. Now, the second point is that if you move beyond individual heritage and look at heritage as a broader category, maybe for each period, in that case, even when it is diminished in its entirety or in a bigger category, it will only attract additional mystery and additional interest by future generations, increasing their heritage value. So I mean, if, say, the whole heritage, or nearly the whole heritage of one period, of one region, would disappear in some, as a result of some process, that it would not diminish the value of the resource, but it would in fact increase it and make it more interesting and significant. Think, for example, of the amount of evidence they have about the earliest human origin. It often is a few teeth and some fragments of skulls, maybe. It's really not a lot, but this is probably the period that attracts the most popular interest and fascinates people the most. And one of the reasons is that it is so enigmatic, so mysterious, that you know so little. And all the details that you can learn, nevertheless, from these two teeth. So it's not a disadvantage for the heritage that you may have less material. In fact, it may be the opposite, maybe positive. After all, as you all know, the archaeological theory, a lot of it grew out of prehistory, a lot of history of medieval archaeology, and one of the explanations people give is that this is because they're used to interpretation and theory as a less material to overwhelm scholars than it is in later period. So these were the other significant substantial point of the argument that heritage cannot go extinct anyway, and destruction is not crucial and not as much a problem as it was claimed. So I want to conclude with my implication of this argument. And then I come back to the ethical point. Ethically, I argue, it would be preferable to plan which archaeological resources are needed for the specific quality, either now or in the future, and then to enhance, regenerate, or generate them for that purpose. And that's much preferable to the alternative, which is worrying about which particular class of tangible objects may be diminished in quantity right now. Tangible objects that may not have much value at all, that can tell us about any story about the past we like. So if anything, then the ethics would ask us to design and manage and generate archaeological heritage today for the benefit of living and future generations. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Cornelius. That was very eloquently put, Cornelius. I think I disagree with pretty much everything you said. So that should get the argument going very, very nicely. Where to begin? Definitions.
Okay. I don't want to make any.
Okay. Let's Cornelius has set out a very clear argument in four parts. Definitions, the context, the argument, and his conclusion. He talked about, in terms of definitions, the archaeological resource, tangible objects that remind us of the human past. He talked about how finite, limited in quality, but actually it's not, and renewable, he talked about it being regenerated. Let me pick up on a few things, therefore. The archaeological resource, what is that? It is the physical remains of the human past. What value we put on that is the social context, and that's a lot of what Cornelius was talking about, the social context. But there is a physicality to that past, whether we like it or not. Our values change, the physicality of the past doesn't. And because humans, as a species, have a finite history, that physicality has a finite existence. Finite, infinite. I think part of the problem with the motion is that some of the terminology is woolly. And I have a lot of sympathy with Cornelius in terms of looking at the infinite. He used the word replaceable. I do agree that archaeology is replaceable in the sense that we generate new archaeology. Think of a glacier. At the top of the mountain, we have new ice being laid down. That's our new archaeology. That's our fresh archaeology. We all know the concept that everything we generate can be archaeology. So all those coffee and teacups that we used at lunchtime before the conference, we all threw them away. They're all now archaeology. I think we're familiar with that as a concept. Think of the other end of the glacier, the nose of the glacier, which is either running into the sea or it's running into some upland landscape. There we have ice and snow laid down thousands of years that is constantly being destroyed. And the same, I feel, is true with the archaeology. The glacier itself is finite. It has a finite length. It can expand and it can shrink, and in fact, it can disappear altogether. But the creation of the archaeology is constant. So that much of Cornelius's argument I would agree with. Whether we can see that as renewable, I think is highly subjective. If you're thinking about what a renewable source is, it's something that can be generated again and again to do the same things again and again. And what we're actually talking about is creating different forms of archaeology. So, can the archaeological resource go extinct? Well, of course it can do if the human race goes extinct. Can we lose bits of that archaeological resource? Yes, we can. And to the point where we don't know what bits we've lost. And that's hardly regeneration. That's gaps in our knowledge that we don't even know we have. Now, a lot of what Cornelius said depends upon values and interpretations. How we value the past in the present. By destroying something, we transmute its status into something new. That's, at one level, that's quite true. At another level, what that object was, what that landscape was, what that building was originally, is lost. It cannot be recreated. I have no slides, quite deliberately, because the temptation to have slides is to be emotive. And I think there are several things we can be emotive about. Sabrata, on the coast of northern Libya, has just been taken over by ISIS. ISIS, of course, have been deliberately using the past as a means of provocation by blowing it up, by destroying objects. A technique that we can trace back to the Greeks, the Romans, we can see it in the Crusader campaigns, we can see it in the English Civil War, we can even see it in the Reformation. Is that creating new archaeology, or is it destroying archaeology? It's destroying something and replacing it with something different. The fact you replace it with something different does not mean that what has been destroyed is recoverable. So we have problems with our definitions. In terms of the archaeological resource, we have to think about the physicality. If we move on to talk about values, which we need to, we have to recognise those values are rooted in a current social context. That current social context changes. The physicality of the past doesn't. If we're talking about infinite resources, then you have to bear in mind that nothing is infinite. The universe itself has a lifespan. But nothing is infinite. If you talk about particular types of archaeology, then it's possible to lose most of that. Just because you only have one or two items left of that type of archaeology, which increases its potential research value, does not mean that we are able to understand wholly what went on in the past. We have huge gaps which we have lost. Therefore, it is finite. And in terms of renewable, renewable, replaceable, archaeology is being generated all the time. So what I would say is that we mustn't get caught up in the semantics of the argument. It's very easy to get distracted by values and interpretations. Archaeology is rooted in landscapes, it's rooted in objects, and those objects reflect people's lives. People are born, people have children, people die. They leave behind archaeological material, the physicality of the past. And if we are going to make a judgment as to planning for future archaeological resources, curating, if you like, certain types of archaeology, then we have to acknowledge in doing that we are saying other types of archaeology are not important. That means we are passing a value judgment. That means implicitly that that archaeology is being discarded. Is that what we really mean in this debate? I don't think it is. So, what I would say is that this debate is both a typical piece of tag whimsy, absolutely typical, designed to irritate and annoy and get people involved. And that is, of course, what tag debates should be about. But in amongst all of that whimsy, there is a very serious issue here, because we are talking about dealing with archaeology potentially in a completely different way. We're talking about saying we're not going to do certain things because this source is infinite. This source is renewable. And that will allow other groups in our contemporary society to say, well, we won't invest, we won't acknowledge, we won't accept the arguments about the importance of that particular archaeological resource. If we talk about values, values are at the heart of this motion this afternoon. If we talk about those values, then we have to acknowledge that other groups, other individuals, have values as well. And they don't necessarily correspond with our own values. In fact, even within the archaeology family, I could very easily see that the values of academic archaeologists will not be the same as the values of professional archaeologists, which will not be the same as the values of museum archaeologists, and won't be the same as the values of voluntary archaeologists. So who are we to say that the archaeological resource should be treated in that way? That we should say it is infinite, it is renewable, and therefore from that flows a series of value systems which we are going to ask you to take on board. The theme of this conference is diversity. Diversity of values is part of the archaeological debate. That's why it's central, I suspect, to the way we are debating this afternoon. So, in conclusion, I do think that the archaeological resource is finite. I'm not saying it's not replaceable. It is, but what it's being replaced with is something new. It's being replaced with contemporary social constructs from our contemporary society. And I think we have to bear in mind the archaeological resource is a tangible asset. It's objects, it's structures, it's landscapes that reflects our human past. And each generation of archaeologists interprets that in a different way. And if we start saying that it's infinite, it's renewable, therefore we will do these things here, but we won't do those things over there, then we have to acknowledge that we will not be doing certain types of archaeology, that we'll not be exploring certain elements of the archaeological resource. And what's more, the implication is, it's not worth doing that. After all, the archaeology is renewable and it's infinite. I will leave it at that.
Well, in which case, I call on Dr. Mark Spanier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Are you going to speak for or against?
I'm going to speak for. My learned colleague and opponent in this case, Mike, has put a context on things which I would call political, social-political. There is a certain degree of realism there. I will agree with it. But I've had the great pleasure in the past to have been at EEA conferences and talked to Willem Willems, who was one of the fathers of the Malta Treaty. And in essence, what we do as archaeologists in, well, some part of the Malta Treaty, is telling lies. This is part, the point you make, of what I call the big lie. Don't misunderstand me, this is quite respectfully, because the big lie is beneficial. The big lie is meant to stop things, to explain things to a broader public. It is there to further a cause. And the cause here, to be further, is, well, a growing sense of identity, a growing connection to the archaeology, a real worry of that development is, well, taking sources away. But that said, we are not here in the room discussing politics. We are discussing emotion here. Once upon a time, there was no archaeology. It's a sad place. The earth was empty, etc., etc. Archaeology grows with us. And at the same time, there's lots we don't know. And I could even argue with some of the other esteemed colleagues that the past is unknowable. And therefore, that the social construct, as we perceive the past, is the most important thing we have of the past, or this idea of the past. And therefore, I would say that this thing is renewal. If we have inspiration, if we have tangible stuff, if we have things like the Berlin Wall, which I think is horrendous, but that's another point, it is there to root our society. Our policies, our aims, our big lies are there to make archaeology work as fulfilling a need in society. And therefore, archaeology is definitely infinite, because we will always tell stories. And therefore, it is renewable, because every generation will get its own take on it. That said, let's say that archaeology is finite, and we have things in our depots, in museums, etc. Our esteemed colleagues who do classical studies have what they call corpus. Their whole source is there and could be put on a DVD or even a Blu-ray maps, and it's all the written sources they have. And lo and behold, they have been able to pump out for the last 300 years on this limited corpus a lot of new stories. So even if it was finite archaeology, it is still a source of renewable, and it's still doing the job which needs to be done in archaeology. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Rebecca Thornton. I am a third year archaeology student at the University of Chester, and I have been very interested in this debate from when I realised it was happening in the programme, because I want to speak for the motion that archaeology is renewable and it is fine, it is infinite, because we, as Cornelius said, are constantly creating this archaeology and we are constantly using things. From a student's perspective, and this may come across as being quite controversial to some of you, a lot of the older people in this room have had great fun on excavations. You've been through the high period of archaeology from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s. As a student, although I am a mature student, I want that opportunity. I do not want the older people of this world to be able to have had all the fun quite frankly. So, truthfully, I think we should keep excavating, because what if that site that you suddenly discover in the middle of a field in Cheshire can tell you something so important about our joint past that to not excavate it would almost be criminal? Subjectivity is part of what we do as archaeologists, and there are many different areas for us to look at. One of the things that I noticed in the 1990s literature that I have been reading, I think it was Gavin Lucas and somebody else, they excavated a council house that was still standing. Somebody had recently left. Now that is archaeology just as much as digging in the ground. So we should be looking at archaeology in a way where things that we are doing now can also be investigated archaeologically. And therefore, I would also argue that the politics of the situation, as mentioned by one of the previous speakers, I'm afraid I've forgotten your name. I've got a 5 second memory. Mentioned about ISIS. Now, what would happen if the worst really did come to the worst? We have the opportunity now to look at our past as much as possible, because nobody knows what happens in the future politically. If we don't dig it, if we don't investigate it, if we don't record it, yes, okay, it may be lost in the immediate, but we do keep records.
Are you speaking for or against?
That's a good question. I'm not sure.
You could be neutral.
I've been thinking the whole time whether to be for or against this, and I'm not sure, because I think the terms in which the debate has been phrased are actually mixing up two different things. I'm very struck that Mike very eloquently talked about the archaeological resource as a thing, whereas Cornelius very eloquently talked about archaeology as a set of processes, a relationship we have with those things. And to some extent, those two things are somewhat different. Now, I take very much your point. I'm one of that generation that had bloody good fun doing archaeology, and I still have that amount of fun. And I want you lot to have fun as well. I think, on balance, I'm going to come down in favour of the motion, but it's with a sort of caveat, in a way. Yes, the archaeological resource, I think, is limited in certain aspects and is finite if you're looking at, say, prehistory or Roman. It is renewable at the other end, yes. The values we put on that resource are renewable always, always, and always. My problem with those who advocate that the resource is finite, the next sentence comes, and therefore it must be protected at all costs. That's where I have the problem. You end up with archaeologists being the conservators of remains instead of the investigators of remains. And that is where I have the problem. And I think that absolutely right that we should be spending public money to conserve and protect scarce aspects of the archaeological record, but we must do it because there is a reason for doing it, not just because it's scarce. And the reason to do it is to understand human beings and human behaviour from the past and in the present. And unless you do that understanding, we become a profession which fossilises the physical remains as something inherent in themselves. We reify and deify the archaeological remains, and we cease being archaeologists, which, after all, is the study of those remains. You can't study them unless, as you say, you excavate. So it's with reluctance I come out against Mike's point, because I think there is a danger with Mike's point of view that we cease to be actually archaeologists. That's, I think, all I will say.
And it will be very brief, but two observations. So I'm actually against, at this point, against the motion. I am
Mesolithic Spence Carter, CPA Yorkshire, and all sorts of other umbrellas. Having listened to the proposal and counter-proposal, and actually to build on Don's point, this has been a little developing story. We are literally, I think, objectifying the archaeological record. We've talked about walls. We've talked about objects. We've talked about sites. And for me, there's a third or fourth element which we're not talking about, and which is absolutely inherent in our discipline and allied disciplines. And for me, that's context. And I don't think the context of objectified data, scraps of pottery, flint, whatever it is, up to whole sites, even the Parthenon, which is my corollary to the Berlin Wall scenario of transformation, without the context, we're pretty much lost, and we always have been. And for me, the context, and I think beyond the Daesh world and what the horrifying things happening at the moment, you look at looting that's been happening probably constantly, it's the context on a mass scale that is absolutely finite. So I think that was a nuance that I think may develop through the day, and hopefully I've added to that. The other reason that I'm against the motion and with Mike is what Mike said, if I capture this in a snapshot. If we think about the results of being pro the motion, what I find compelling right now is that sense of diversity beyond the archaeological community. We have all sorts of vested interests which are political as well, not just through funding, but people are using our past, the narratives of our past, for various different reasons. And it was that sense that, if you agree with the motion, we're breeding complacency beyond the boundaries of the world that we're familiar with. If that makes sense, I hope. So that's my set of observations, more than anything.
I was going to put up red and I was going to put up green, and I thought I'd put up white just to be wishy-washy. Okay, so what I wanted to simply say very briefly is that when we get to these debates, we end up talking about some very nauseating, clichéd examples, such as ISIS, and we talk about Stonehenge. I don't want to give a flying fart what they do with Stonehenge, and I'm not really too passionate about what happened to Palmyra. My perspective is about something which is in universal, which is about human mortality, and the funerary record, or the aspect of archaeology that's funerary. And here, I flip from Cornelius's perspective to Mike's very strongly and angrily, and have arguments with myself late at night and in the morning, because to suggest that the human funerary record is renewable is insidious and dangerous, because every human life is unique, and to start suggesting that human lives can be just reproduced, and that a new life and a new death, a new burial, is somehow equivalent to one that is neglected from the past, is incredibly problematic. In the same way that we can say that our responsibility as archaeologists, having excavated those remains, having taken them out of context, to then neglect them in some other fashion is incredibly insidious and dangerous. And yet, on the other hand, I think the discourse on care, focusing care on only particular kinds of funerary remains from particular kinds of periods, not recognising that people are going to continue to dispose of the dead, and the importance of how and where and in what fashions we dispose of the dead into the future, should be secondary to preserving a few Bronze Age barrows where we valorise simply the final capping of those multi-phase monuments rather than the complex stories the processes in which they came into being, and the respect and care, supposedly, that word care, over a few effigy tombs in churches, over the very vast remains that have been neglected by archaeologists, the charnel, the disturbed, the complex processes that make up the churchyard, is incredibly problematic in itself. We end up using that discourse of protection and care and finite resource to continue to obsess about a tiny minority of the human dead, which is why I find it exciting and also problematic that we bend over backwards to valorise immortal bog bodies, mummies and English kings, And we're happy to do that for the in the context of public archaeology, and to continue to neglect debates about death today, the death of future generations, and the vast majority of people who died in the past. So I get very angry at myself and about this debate. I don't think it's whimsical. I think it's really important for funerary archaeology in particular. And it's very easy to get sucked into this view of seeing it. Oh, you can't just dismiss the remains as renewable because that is ethically problematic. I think it's ethically problematic from both sides. But I find myself coming down slightly in favour of the idea of renewables, because thinking in that fashion allows us to think about the care as not situated in terms of protection, but in terms of human relationships with mortality. And this is an issue that's not about the distant past only. It's not about particular sealed funerary contexts. It's about our society and our future for the dead, of what we end up deciding we're going to do with the dead over the future generations. So yes, in that sense, we do have to think about the past and funerary remains as renewable.
Hi, hello. I'm a student from Northern Germany. Yeah, I'm speaking against just because I think there's two things going on here. I think on one hand, we're focusing too much on the idea that interpretation, that it's based exclusively on the human being. And that as long as we have that, you know, archaeology is renewable. I think that's partly incorrect. On the other hand, I don't think that what matters is the physicality. I think what matters is the actual history that's there. When we think of archaeology and how it developed, it wasn't based exclusively on the fact that there are physical things out there that need to be studied, no matter how old. It's the fact that there's a history there that needs to be studied. And I think it's important to, you know, and I think part of the discourse now, you know, materiality, especially in archaeology and the work of Olson and whatnot, I think they're collapsing that distinction between that there's an interpretation that is human, that we interpret things, and that there's just this physicality, this physical thing, this objectified object out there. And my perspective is that there's a history that is physical and that is also simultaneously interpreted. So in a way, I'm kind of, I said I was against, but actually it's more white than but I still disagree with the fact that that archaeological heritage is renewable. Thank
okay.
you.
I think I broadly come down for the motion, because although I agree with the last student saying that there is a physicality there, it's never just untouched nature. The object was created by people in the first place. So even if you inherit something from your mother or your father, you have a different impression of that to what they did. And I think that's really important. You can't get away from the socio-political impacts of things. And you have to sort of accept that you can never fully... We can't invent a time machine and go back to the past and know exactly what happened and which interpretations are right and which interpretations are wrong. And even if we, as our society, privilege one version of that interpretation and we think that we know better, we can't ever know that for sure. So at the end of the day, we have to move past that and say, well, all interpretations are interpretations. There's no way, even when you're recording a section, you're still interpreting that. That's not objective. There's no objectivity in archaeology. So to try and conserve something is also subjective, because if, to go back to the cliche of Stonehenge, they're now conserving it by putting glass and things like that, but that changes the landscape. So that depends on, as an archaeologist, what you value, whether it's phenology. I don't know how to pronounce that, but landscape archaeology or the actual stones themselves. So, yeah, I think to conclude, I think that I come down in favour of the motion, because there are no certainties and therefore it is renewable, even as long as we record things adequately, it's renewable to an extent.
by, in this case, my good friend Mike. yes, that's something we do. The big lie thing. I made very short of it, and I pointed out that the big lie is beneficial. And I would like to add something on that: the idea that you take care of it, that something is finite, is a driving force for the fun factor, as you said, of being able to be in the field. The big lie, as perpetrated by, well, the generation before us, at making clear what the value is by telling the big lie, it has been successful. Working in the Netherlands, I've seen a huge upsweep of young archaeological talent till 5 or 6 years ago, which were able to have their fun and be researchers. And if I, as an archaeologist, look at some of the monuments I have in the Netherlands, I see a green meadow, and there are cows on it, or there are no cows on it, or there are sheep on it, and there is a farmer there telling me that he has problems because, well, the beast cannot shed too much because there is archaeology underneath. But it's only because the farmer is there telling me that there is archaeology there, I see the archaeology. And it's there by the means of the story. And at that stage, I can tell him, oh, don't worry, it will be dug up and the problem will go away, etc., etc. But you have to manage the resource. For years and years, we have said, oh, there is enough energy there to make our system work, and now we have global warming. For years and years, we as a society have, well, overspent on packaging of all kinds of things, and because there is a never-ending resource there. So therefore, I can see the point, what Mike was making, on the geopolitical thing, the how to get the message across. The big problem is that many of the archaeologists sort of started to believe this idea. And we lack something else, which is telling the story. Telling story and giving value to it. Because if people appreciate things, then things start to change for them. And it's illogical. I have at home a a cost. It's just a place my great-grandmother put her clothes in. And it's horrendous. It's wooden. It's leaky. It doesn't work. And if I slam the door, it will probably drop out. It's valuable. It's one thing. And I will not let people touch it. I will not have it researched by someone else. I will keep it pristine. And I will try to, as long as I live, to take care of it as best as I can. In the end, on the timescales we are talking as humans, whatever, the closet will be lost. The story and my love of it will be lost. But we have an ethical responsibility in the here and now. And the ethical responsibility we have makes sure that we have to play chess on different boards. Yes, in this room I can say I'm for it, for the motion. But the reality is that I go outside this room and I'll talk to a developer, and I will be against the motion. Because that's, I would even say that lying at that stage, being aware of this discussion, is the ethical thing to do. Because in my life, what I can reach, that finite amount of archaeology there, in my lifetime, where I have a responsibility, I have to fill it in. And I can be very broad and be academic and theoretical about it, but that's not what my public sees. My public is partly a developer, and he wants a solution. My public is my students, who want to have a story. And you have a responsibility as archaeologists to switch and take the other point, which is, well, not very loved in this room at this stage, of the against very serious. Because it's making the world tick. So I should slowly move towards... But I'm a theory conference, so I like to be a bit more free of the constraints I have in the outside world. But there is this thing of definitions and is this searching for an absolute truth. But the truth is best there, kept in your heart and hidden at many stages of life. And that's the point I would like to make, and I will still be learned opponent against or for the motion, I have to say.
My partner's working on repatriation of human remains. It just struck me that's a very interesting example, perhaps, because we can certainly talk about human remains as being quite renewable. There's no biological uniqueness in that sense, in the way that an artifact is created in a unique way. Well, I suppose we're all unique, but we regenerate in an ongoing way. But how do we then deal with this issue of I missed the first part of this discussion. I didn't really want to jump in, but so I'm guessing a little bit about what was said earlier. we have this human remains. You talk about the cabinet has personal value. It's very much an object. It's defined in its sort of personal sense. You wouldn't want it researched. The same goes for the human remains as well, in that they especially old material, has enormous value in terms of research, but there's this constant problem of it's also considered personal sort of ancestors to some group or other. And that was really the point I was trying to make. I didn't want to come up here and say that. I just to expand on the sort of examples of the kinds of real-world situations where these become actually contested rather than just theoretical. So, like, the repatriation of human remains is very concrete in this sort of discussion, I think. And it crosses the boundaries because we're talking about the actual material itself, like I say, is going to be regenerated in some way a lot of the times. But maybe these communities aren't. And if you start to think about what sort of cultural legacy of an indigenous group is, for example, then it's another way of looking at what's finite and what's not. And it thinks very much about perspective. From a scientific view, it's finite when we can measure it and get to the end of the measure. But that's only based on our objective scientific measures are only based on our subjective ability to make the right measure. We don't know we've got to the end of a quantity until until that point. It's subjective until then. But we take an objective method towards it. I think you're right that in terms of actually protecting archaeology, I'm a commercial archaeologist, then to argue that it's a completely renewable resource. It's very dangerous faced with people who are quite happy to just have it all removed. The only way to argue for it is that it is in some way unique and valuable as it is. But this is a spectrum. We draw these distinctions, objective and subjective, finite, infinite. But there's a spectrum between them. So instead of it being one or the other, it's more about significance. Some parts of the archaeological record, it's not so much that they're renewable, but they're replicated in many ways and have lower level of significance, perhaps, or perhaps that's how we should think about it, compared to other parts, early human remains, which are incredibly valuable and can't be replicated. And the other point I was thinking of earlier is not just the objects themselves, it's their context of discovery. And so for the Paleolithic, for example, that's absolutely key and can't be replicated. It is obviously a very finite resource, which we only discover once. Once we actually come across it, this is the problem. We can't define what's out there until we've come across it in this sphere. Anyway, I'll just finish.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you all and those of you who have joined us as well as those of you who have returned. One of the things we've had a lot of today is people actually coming to a lot of agreement with each other, and that's really great to see. But there was one thing that Mike said that I really want to take issue with, and that's good because he was the speaker I meant to be speaking opposite. But he said that the debate was whimsical, a typical tag whimsy designed to irritate. And I really want to take issue with that. I honestly believe that this is an incredibly important and serious matter to decide. If it is, as Dr. Spangler has suggested, the big lie that we are have to record these things and we have to deal with them because they are finite and non-renewable, as we constantly say to our developer colleagues, to our audiences around the world, if that's a lie, that's really unacceptable. It's really unacceptable for us to be taking public or private money on the basis of a lie. We need to be giving people value that we believe in. And if we sit inside our ivory towers and say, well, yes, we know that's not true, but we have to say it to the developers, that is deeply shocking. And if we say, well, we don't really know if it's true or not, it kind of is finite, it kind of isn't finite, and there's aspects of both, well, that's not acceptable either. This is the core of what we make of our discipline. We need to know what the nature of our resource is. Is our resource finite, or is it not finite? That matters. And I'm pleased to see we have a good crowd here today, and I do hope that people who watch it consider the matter and people discuss it. Because as Cornelius said at the beginning, he wrote his paper on this basis, saying that it was renewable 15 years ago. And I have yet to see a real rebuttal of that. And yet, most of our legislation continues to run as if it were non-renewable. So we need to consider, and we need to think about it. And it is not just a matter of whimsy that this debate is being had. So if I can go back briefly to the definitions. Cornelius defined archaeological resources as tangible objects that remind us of the human past. Mike challenged this definition in saying that they are the physical remains of the human past. And there is a very big distinction between those two, because Mike's definition implies that there was a whole human past, that parts of it have remained. And that is one of the underpinning notions behind the non-renewable argument that I think we have to kind of pull out. Okay? But it isn't in keeping with an awful lot of other theoretical understandings that there is this whole of which we have little bits falling down to us that we can scoop up. That's not the way that most archaeological thinking and research operates today. And while not everybody is a full-on constructivist and running with the notion that people will, that these things are created by our activities. Nonetheless, it is really important for us to see that the notion of a whole past of which we have the jigsaw pieces remaining is not really what's driving most archaeological work today. So I think I would like to go back to the definition that Cornelius gave as tangible objects that remind us of the human past. And in that sense, we need to clarify that when Cornelius says that those things are not limited in quantity, the finite definition, he is not saying that this is because in drinking cups of coffee today we are creating new archaeology. It is because by being archaeologists we are creating new archaeology. That archaeological research creates the archaeological resource. And if you think that that is in some way a perverse statement, then we should go to the Panning Policy Statement 5, which was briefly enforced, which underpins the National Policy Planning Policy Framework statement, in which archaeological interest is described as having an interest in doing archaeological research. Historical interest is being able to tell us something about the past. We could have used those definitions. I think Cornelius was right to use a broader definition not pinned to UK legislation. But the reason I bring those up is because you can see that the way that historical interest is created, the historical interest in an action, is created through archaeological research. It is by archaeological research that something stops just being a cup and starts being a cup that can tell us something. So when we think about what the archaeological resource is, it isn't just objects. And Spencer's point about context was terribly important. Awfully pleased that you made it. Because it isn't just objects, and it isn't just context, and it isn't just interpretation. They are hybrids. Yeah? And we're often very uncomfortable with hybrids in every aspect of life, but there is no way around the fact that the archaeological resource is a hybrid that is created through archaeological research. So we are, I think we're happy enough that nobody is suggesting that it's individual items we're talking about, because obviously individual items can be destroyed. So I don't need to worry about the fact that we're not talking about individual items. But when we think about the way that these individual items work, we do need to ask ourselves when individual items are destroyed or transformed or removed from context, what does that do to our capacity to understand the diversity of the past? And I think that, again, what we have to do in this circumstance is recognize that we are... that's a five, is it?
This is fine.
Thank you, that's a five. What we have to do with recognizing that is that what it does is it always increases our capacity to speak of the diversity of the past, because it creates something new. Because when we have lost the interpretation or the constellation of context, object, and interpretation that we had, either through the transformation, physical transformation of the object, its relocation, or a change of our understanding of it, what we have created is something new. And whenever we create something new, we increase diversity. Now, of course, it's true that increasing that diversity, we might lose some of our understandings that we had. And so, but that is not a product of having created the new interpretation or the new understanding. It's a product of having forgotten things, which, sadly to say, as someone who's just turned 50, happens all the time. the fact that we forget things, the fact that sometimes we choose to forget things, is a slightly different question than whether or not archaeological resources are needed to support the memorialization. It's a separate question. So I want to come back to this question of what we tell people on the outside, because, as I said, I think that is crucially important. And this idea that we can only get money from people if they think that things are endangered. We can only call for the interest and the conservation of things if we think that they're endangered. I think that's the thing we have to address, because we regularly care about things that aren't endangered. Yeah? People care desperately about Strictly Come Dancing. People love puppies. People are come to care about all sorts of things that are in no way endangered, right? So if we want to look at getting people to care about archaeology, we need to look at the kinds of things that people care about. And people care about things that have emotional content. They care about things that mean things to them personally. They care about the kinds of things that archaeologists do all the time. Yeah? And if we say that those things aren't important, or, as one of the speakers from the floor, say we can't do a piece of investigation on a stone axe because that stone axe might be destroyed, when in fact we might be able to make much more, we're in no way doing either archaeology or our audience as a service by saying that we must not tell new stories because they might destroy some fabric, because that's privileging one aspect of that little triangle that we talked about over all the others, in a way that it makes us, as a number of people from the floor have said, curators and not investigators. What's more, I think an argument that I've made that's in the other thing, there's important to remember the endangerment narrative is actually quite corrosive, because it has an effect of domesticating the past. Whenever we are concerned about not wanting to lose things, then that puts us in a wonderfully powerful position. Goodness me, we might lose this Victorian school. What a lovely thing, and we're in a position to keep it, yeah? That's the emotional thing. We feel good, we feel strong. We forget what it was like to be in a Victorian school. We don't talk about the terrors of the past. We don't talk about what a castle might represent, or what a human sacrifice might represent, or what an empire that builds buildings like Palmyra might mean if we have to sit around and worry about, oh, poor Palmyra, instead of that horror that was an empire that built something like that. And in fact, in many ways, destroying things and allowing people to destroy things that offend them, that disturb them, increases the connections that people have to them. These are things that I don't have time to go into in great detail, but I just want to point out that endangerment leads us, the endangerment narrative leads us to, as many people here pointed out, quite fossilized interpretation, and sometimes fossilizing a particular generation's view of the world, when they were allowed to destroy things, but not us. But sometimes just, generally speaking, a considerably more conservative approach, and as I say, a domestication of the past. Also, I want to say there are other ways that we can lose things. We can lose things by having new information. For instance, we've lost the past that had the Druids at Stonehenge. It's gone because we actually have put a whole load more research into it, and we can see that the Druids did not build Stonehenge. So all of that which was important to people is gone. Now, it's not gone because we still know it did happen. But so the reason I bring it up is to say that we can lose things through gaining new things just as easily as we can lose things by destroying them. So if the concern is about loss, then the concern should not be around the question of finite or renewable, because the fact we constantly renew these things through that little triangle comes in. There is something finite in all of this. And what there is finite is how much time I have left to speak. And that is not just how much time I have to speak, but how much time any of us have to speak. How much attention we have to give to these things. And that was Cornelius's point about the ethics. If archaeology matters, we must be focusing our attention on the things that matter. We cannot be spending our time constantly trying to save what we conceive of as a crumbling jigsaw. We must be out there creating and renewing things that are useful to people in the world today, because that is, in fact, our job. And in that, then, even if we think of ourselves as curators, we need to turn to the question of the ethics of profusion. As curators recognize they can't keep everything, and we recognize we can't understand everything, we need to use our time well. We need to make sure that what we do is truthful and sincere. And on that, I will end.
Mainly speaking for, but a little bit against as well. I'm Rachel from the University of Chester, and I'm third year like Rebecca. So I've been sitting this all morning because I have the social interaction of a wet smart price tea bag, so I apologise if I speak pretty badly. So archaeology is a renewable resource. Personally, I think in a way archaeology is and can become a greater renewable resource. In a way that myself, I spend too much time on games, which means I'm really into virtual worlds and all that fun stuff. So I think real archaeology could become a better renewable resource if we use technology. Like, the problem with copies, that's what I'm gonna start. I know there's a problem with copies. If you take your good old stone axe and you draw a picture of it, it doesn't mean it's the same thing. But what if you made a 3D drawing of it, exact replica, is it the same thing? Not to us, but in 100 years when somebody picks up that copy, will they consider it any different and care? To make it on a bigger scale, the idea I did, does anybody at all know what E3 is? It's just a gaming conference like this. It's really big in America. So this year they displayed a new version of Minecraft. I'm sure everybody's heard of Minecraft, yeah? Where you take your Oculus Rift, which is your virtual reality headset, and it projects your Minecraft world in detail as like a hologram in front of you. And you could go into it and you could pull open and you could look at all these virtual worlds. Now say we could apply that to excavations. Say, in the future, we got so good that we could use this similar technology to record the excavation exactly as it is being created on this virtual world, and we could take it and anybody could look at this excavation and go through its layers and re-excavate it. Does that devalue it for the future or not? Or does it bring better interpretations for the future because archaeology is destruction and once we've excavated that site, it's gone. It's an odd thought, and I know it's a bit technology-based and a bit weird, but I think that if that this kind of thing could happen, that would make archaeology more of a renewable resource. However, my against point is, if you give me a picture of a game and not the game to play, I'm going to bite your head off because I don't find it fun. It's not the same. But is that my personal opinion, or does that matter? I'm trying to say that just because we find the copy bad and not valued, will somebody in the future care about that?
Thank you very much indeed for your contribution.
So that's critical, how people think and use the past. And the most practical part of that we have in the UK at the moment is through the local archives and the way they try and encourage people to come in and do their own research. And I think that's, it's very germane to the overall point, because the survival of those archives as county council services is absolutely dependent on them being used. And it's absolutely critical for any archive to be used rather than just be a store of material. On the other hand, I'm going to stick very stubbornly to the other side of the debate. And what you mentioned about giving people value, personal value, and this is how they come to view, reinterpret and take narrative from the material in front of them. I think the finiteness of it actually gives it significance. Rather than creating a corrosive narrative, I think the impending doom facing us all is an enormous imperative to seeing the beauty and value in something that is finite. But maybe these are just poetic differences.
Thank you very much indeed, Dan.
I am against the first half of the motion, very definitely, but I'm completely for the second half. So I'd argue that the archaeological resource is not renewable, because I'm thinking about objects, but I think you can apply this to sites, features, anything, that any interaction we have, the context of the objects and any interaction we have with the object, the site or the feature is always going to be different. It's never going to be the same. That you could be working on a site one day, you could go back the next day and be feeling, could have had an argument with someone the night before and then be feeling completely different about the whole thing. So I would argue that, therefore, if the archaeological resource is made up of us and our reactions to it, it's never ever going to be the same. So therefore, it is unrepeatable and unique and non-renewable. But I would argue that possibly even because of this, because of this, I mean, there's never going to be one answer to anything. And if there's never one answer or one view to anything, why are we saving things till people can answer those questions better than us? So I think that just because it's non-renewable doesn't mean it should be safe for future generations. And actually, that's the concept that, in a way, I have more problems with, is the idea of saving things for future generations. Because who is the future generation? Is it the next generation, or is it the one after them? And that, to me, seems more of a cliche. Like, we trot it out all the time, oh, safe for future generations. But are we ever actually exploring that? Because I think it's a bit of a... It's always tinged with negativity that we don't have the money or the resources to deal with it yet. We might in the future, but we don't yet. And that brings up all notions of progress and like, oh, well, we're only going to get better. Everything's always getting better. And that's problematic in itself. And it also feels like we're always speaking from a constant state of regret that people have got rid of stuff before us, so we better not get rid of stuff now. So... That's the other thing. So, yes, I disagree that archaeology is renewable. I don't think it is. But I do agree that we should promote and we should celebrate. And I love that word, because we should celebrate archaeology. And we should investigate archaeology. And we shouldn't be saying, don't touch. You can't touch it now. We might touch it in the future, but not you. Because that's just making us the keepers, which I think people have argued. And I think actually touching it and celebrating it and doing stuff with it would do more to engage people with heritage. Which is a good thing.
Great.
I wanted to say something really meaningless. The Beowulf poet, who is anonymous, I think gives us a very powerful image to reflect on this question, namely, where does care reside? The poet of Beowulf
tells us the most fabulous treasure we know from the Middle Ages, probably never really found, was never kept. It was disposed of. That he imagines us as the last survivor of the giant race, disposing of a hoard in a chambered tomb, and later becoming guarded by the dragon, only to be revealed after Wiglaf and Beowulf slay the dragon. But that treasure is then interred with Beowulf himself. It's interred in Beowulf's tomb. It's not kept by the people. It's cursed gold. An idea that bothered Tolkien and dominated The Hobbit. Now, my point here is, where did care reside? For the Beowulf poet, the last survivor's anxiety was that he was the last survivor. He was not burying, as some archaeologists have suggested, a set of grave goods. He was collecting all of the treasures of his folk and interring them in a tomb that wasn't a tomb, it was an anti-tomb. It was lost treasure that had no owner, had no grave to go into. It was the utter sense of loss. And for the Beowulf poet, the killing of the dragon retrieves that treasure, not to be used, not to be displayed in a museum, not to be engaged school children, but to then bury in a fitting manner. Today we're obsessed with loss and loss of people out of place. And my point is, I think a lot of the debate is not about where that treasure or those objects reside, but where is care? Is care in the preservation in situ? Is care in the detailed excavation, display in the museum curation? Or is care, as in the repatriation debate, sometimes has to reside in destruction?
Okay.
We have talked a lot about renewable and non-renewable, and we've talked about ivory towers, and we've talked about that we're not talking about specific individual resources. I'm not sure I'm happy with that, actually. And maybe I can take it on a slightly alternate route from the ivory tower to perhaps the real world. In Simon Hawkins' novel, that I have a picture of here, God disappears, a power struggle ensues, and to cut a long story very short, a new god emerges. And this new god's one of its first steps is to replace the sun with a black spherical equivalent. Humanity rebels. God doesn't really have much sympathy for this and explains that, oh, yes, ecosystems will fail, but humanity will prevail. Humanity will adapt. Life will go on. What's the big deal? And so while we sit here and talk about whether archaeology is renewable or not, I think we have to think about a macro level and a micro level and what this means at different levels. And we can't just talk at one without thinking about the other. At a macro level, we've talked about things like the renewability makes sense at a macro level, where we're concerned about, oh, well, archaeologists have employment. Yeah, so there will always be something to excavate because archaeology is renewable. Will academic archaeologists have research material? Well, yes, if archaeology is renewable, then they will. Will people have attractions to visit? Yes, we can always come up with new attractions because archaeology is renewable. And as the DCMS 2015 review of the social impacts of culture and sport, one of the big values of culture is that it gives people opportunities to volunteer. And so, yes, if archaeology is renewable, then there will also still be opportunities for people to do volunteering. But we've got to think about who is archaeology for and what does archaeology do. My PhD project at the University of York is in cooperation with the Council for British Archaeology, who have the slogan "Archaeology for All." Archaeology is not just for archaeologists. And what are other people's interests in archaeology? And what does archaeology do? Thinking about archaeological processes like excavation, for example, or by extension, conservation, it has been said that excavation is destructive, and people reply, well, actually, excavation is creative. I'd like to suggest that archaeology and archaeological processes are transformative, but that there's a big difference between something being transformed and something being renewed. And I think that is my biggest problem with the motion. So what are archaeological resources? You may well have heard of the famous Indian telling of six blind men who touch something and describe what it is they're touching. What is a wall, a snake, a spear, a tree, a fan, and a rope all at the same time? Well, it is an elephant. And in many ways, archaeological resources are like this. They mean very different things to different people. Even among archaeologists, an archaeological resource may mean something very different. In collections, are we using something for sampling? Yes, you mentioned. Are we using things for research? Are we using things for display? Are we using things in a range of different ways that see archaeological resources in very different ways? And how do people who aren't archaeologists relate to these things very differently from us? Who do archaeological resources belong to? In 2007, the TAG conference was in York, and there was a session on taking archaeology out of heritage, which became a book. And the archaeologist's response essentially was, well, why would archaeology want to leave? But I think that wasn't really the question. The question is about archaeology has risen to the status of a deity in the heritage sphere, and what archaeologists say about archaeological resources, which also double as heritage resources to many other people, what archaeologists say about them and what they are have consequences for many other people than archaeologists. And that's why I'd like to suggest that labeling archaeological resources as renewable is inaccurate and it's irresponsible. And that is what this debate is about. It's not about whether they are renewable or non-renewable. It's whether we approve of terming them renewable. People care about archaeology, about heritage. This is a print screen from a crowd justice website where over £12,000 were raised by a retiree to contest a court decision to allow significant changes to the Butterley Spillway, which is owned by Yorkshire Water. People care enough to spend loads of time, loads of money, and they appropriate our language. So the proponents for the motion are quite right that people talk about things such as that our nation's heritage is a finite asset. Once it's gone forever. Well, where did this language come from? It came from us. We're the ones who made it. We gave it to people. It's become the defense mechanism, and now we're talking about ripping it away. So I would like instead to promote a case for talking about that for transformative archaeology rather than renewable archaeology, and that there are crucial distinctions between these two concepts or words. We have talked about, we've kind of talked about the precautionary principle, even though maybe we haven't said that we have. The precautionary principle comes from environmental studies, so nature conservation, which essentially says that responsibility lies on the agent of change. So I want to propose a change, then I must be able to demonstrate that this is not going to damage something else. And this has been, like many other things, has been appropriated by cultural heritage managers and conservators. And I agree with the proponents of the motion that the precautionary principle is very problematic for cultural heritage. I agree that there are problems of profusion, but as I said, I don't agree with the motion. Conservation tries very hard to minimize risk, and this is linked into the precautionary principle. We limit access to researchers because their research is a risk to heritage or to archaeological resources. I think what we often forget, and this is why I think this discussion is very important, is that this way of thinking fails to recognize valorization, the opposite process of damage, which is that new things become archaeological resources, new things become heritage. We change the ways we value things because of our interactions with things or different things that change in society. And the reality is that something can both become less valuable and more valuable. But when we talk about management of archaeological resources, we often assume that things can only get less valuable. So we limit interaction, we limit use, because that's reducing risk of damage. But what it's also doing is it's limiting opportunities for valorization. And so what I would like to suggest is that through use, through, well, responsible use and access, you can engage in processes of valorization at the same time as, yes, you may increase the risk, but that through these processes, archaeological resources are transformed. They're not regenerated. Even in conservation, objects conservation, which is my background, you have this concept of restoration, of restoring something from the past. Well, no conservator can do that. No conservator can bring back the past. The past is gone. We do not restore objects to a previous state. That state no longer exists. So it is not possible to renew and recreate, but we can transform. I don't think that's anything any less valuable, but I still think there's an important distinction between transforming and renewing or recreating. So I'd like to remind you about what this debate is about. As I said, the debate is not about whether heritage should keep the words finite, or archaeological resources should be seen as finite or non-renewable. Mm-hmm. It's just whether or not we want to adopt the word renewable for archaeological resources, yes or no. And so I'd like to suggest that if you are on the fence, and if you're uncomfortable with the word renewable, then you're not really on the fence, you're actually against the motion. And that we can only really be for the motion at this macro level in our ivory tower when we talk about archaeological resources in a very general way. But when we actually look at specifics, and if you take archaeology out of heritage, but if we want to keep archaeology in heritage, and if we want to look at specifics, then archaeological resources aren't renewable, even if they can be transformed. Thank you.
Over to you, Cornelius, then.
Okay.
So the first thing I wanted to say is that it's probably an irony that I'm the only one who isn't being filmed. But that's just as well. But I think I want to go back to what Mike said initially, because he said made one fundamental point, which is correct, because I think many people return to that later on. And that's just a distinction and a different emphasis on him at the no site making much of the idea of the physicality of archaeological resources and the objects that may not be renewable. Whereas I and the pro side were the whole time insisting that you cannot separate the objects from their values and meanings and interpretations and the stories that are connected to them. I think that's absolutely right, and that is actually reflected in the definition of the archaeological resources as tangible objects that can remind us of the past. So there you have the function of the, and the value of the object connected to the archaeological resources, which is what we were talking about. So that separation, which the north side here was proposing, I think is wrong and dangerous. And there's actually a familiar debate that goes back to the 1980s about the character of the archaeological record. And I love what Mike and others said to remind me a bit of that, because the archaeological record is not just a record that documents what people may have done in the past. And if we lose that record, then we don't have that documentation. It's rather like what Sam also was really pointing at as well, the other way around, that it's people in the present who make the archaeology and the archaeological record created as something that becomes valuable as an archaeological source in the present. And without this investment from people in the present, we wouldn't talk about archaeology in the first place. So this doesn't mean that it's only values and only interpretations, and there's no tangible side to it. It rather means that the two are inseparable, and you cannot look at one without the other. Now, what the no side was advocating here to some extent is that they portray themselves as the kind of gatekeeper of the archaeological record. The people who have, we just heard that, have to minimize the risk that this is being destroyed and to try to fight off the developers and support preservation and so on.
And I think this is a position that is, doesn't go well together with the principle of diversity. We heard Harold saying that archaeology is not just for archaeologists, and I would agree with that. But it's not appropriate in that situation that self-appointed gatekeepers in a rather minor profession in society stand up and say, you know, this is okay, and what you say here is not okay because it threatens what I personally believe in. I don't think archaeologists should see themselves as the police of archaeological resources in society. They should rather try to advocate and promote for responsible and beneficial uses of archaeological resources in the present. And this is exactly that I think we should foreground when we talk about care. I think it was a good point about care. So care about archaeological resources for me is involving these resources and valuable practices in the present, and not in gatekeepers trying to stop that or trying to control that. So this is the main point about the archaeological record, which is really in line with a lot of debate since the 1980s, denying that we can separate physicality and the objects for themselves from their significance and values and meaning in society. I just want to add one final point, because there was one, sorry, I didn't hear all the names. In the first speeches on the floor, it was somebody who made an important point about funerary archaeology and the role of human bodies. And obviously that is an important factor, and the argument I was advocating here does not apply to living human bodies, obviously. But as far as dead human bodies and human remains are concerned, I think the argument is different, and it is not necessarily ethically a problem if you see even those human remains as renewable resources. Just one example, there are relics in Catholic churches of all kinds of important holy people associated with the Catholic belief. And if you count all these relics, obviously there are many more relics of certain individuals than they had bones in their body. So it's a lot of that has been renewed and doesn't really have a historic substance to it. And one may have views on that or not, but it's not a problem of, it's not something to do with ethical issues. It's not a way of devaluing the individual. In fact, it's the opposite. It reflects a particular high value of the individual in question, which is the reason why so many bones were attributed to this person. So I think the argument is an interesting one. It's important to focus on bodies and think about them extra carefully, but I don't think it's a problem for this particular argument. So I hope you stick to the opinion that most of you have expressed in this debate. I'd like to thank you all for listening here from Sweden, and especially thanks to those who helped me be with you today, with very small work on Skype accounts, and of course to everybody who spoke. So thanks for now.
Thank you.
So we now come. We have now heard the arguments for and against, and we've heard several arguments for and against from the floor. It now remains in the tradition of parliamentary debate for the House to divide, depending on your how you feel the argument has been sustained. And I would like to ask those who are in favour, the ayes, to go to my right, please, and the noes to go to my left, and then we will see who has won the debate. So we have one abstention, and we have 11 ayes, and 11 noes. And it falls, therefore, to me, as the Speaker of the House, to have the casting vote, and therefore I will cast my vote. The ayes have it.